Because the moment you would arrive, and all the cameras were on Martin Carroll and from that air, and people like that, she would pull the top down. And there there were these bazookas looking. Their tits were a bit as premium in the 1950s. So she destroyed many people's premieres. But when I met her, I just thought, this is the most incredible thing I've ever seen in my life. To see these people. I already had burst of 59 spontaneous bursts of it, so. But it was the size of something else. Obviously, she'd had implants. And so I was taken backstage to meet Monsieur Marcel, the owner. And he said to me, can you sing? And I said, oh, no, I can't sing. He said, can you dance? I said, a little bit. He said, well, what can you do? I said, well, not much, really. He said, okay, you've got the job. I ended up presenting the show to the carousel, and he was marvelous to me. And I said, they were all wonderful. And she and I had called Isley together for a box and nail. And we didn't get on very well. She'd been brought up with prostitutes, and she couldn't read, and she couldn't write. She used to call me m'lady, but not in a nice way, in a sarcastic way. So I used to do my fair lady. And, but the most extraordinary thing happened. After we finished filming, she pulled me aside and she said, you know, April, she said, I always loved you and I always had the greatest respect for you. Blah, blah, blah. But unfortunately, she couldn't come and dine with us. And she kept ringing me up saying, well, can I come over for lunch? And I said, any time, I'd be so honored if you would. Then her husband rang me up and said, she's just had a terrible tumor on top of her head and it's burst. He said, but you'll be very amused to know that none of the doctors can convince her, because she had lovely blonde hair, that the blood is not a ruby tiara. She thought she was wearing a ruby tiara, and she was dead a few days later. It was very sad. But it was lovely to have seen her one last time.
Married with a little boy, and when he took the wig and the makeup off, we all had to walk through the salon to get out after the show. Nobody ever recognized Keating Lustig, because he looked like a little businessman with this briefcase. And yet, made up this woman, stunningly beautiful. From that day, which was in 1961, to this day, which is almost 52 years later, I have never, ever been able to get a job in England. So there you have it. But Arthur was a very strange man. Any captain at Sandhurst who rides side saddle in full uniform. And he used to do that in front of his fellow officers.
The marriage wasn't a great success.
I don't think so. It lasted 14 days. We were married for 7 years, but I mean, he was impossible. He was a schizophrenic. He had two personalities. He was Arthur one minute, and then I always called the female persona that put around, I called her she who must be obeyed. Because he was just outrageous. Yeah. But he promised me if we got married, it would all go away. So I went away.
Of course, it all ended up being caught. A very famous, protracted court case, which had implications, long-term implications.
And many more kind of, I had to be X-ray. They made a startling discovery, by the way, because when they x-rayed all my bones, they discovered that none of my bones were fused. When you reach puberty, your bones fuse. And to this day, my bones haven't fused. So there's just one little incident which should tell them there's something extraordinary going on. And of course, Ormrod, it was a terribly snobby in those days, too. Yeah, this is 1968. And it was terribly snobby because both Arthur and Lord Ormrod had gone to leave them in Oxford, all that nonsense. And he wouldn't listen to any of my team. I had a marvelous team. And he dismissed them as if they were naughty schoolboys, which I found very irritating. And he would, on the third day, we'd have lunch together, the team and I. And I said to my team, incredible professors and doctors, and I said, we've lost this case. And they said, oh, well, don't be so stupid, it's on the third day. I said, no, we've lost this case. And they said, how do you mean? I said, this man will not even look me in the eye when he's asking me a question. That tells me an awful lot. I said, we've lost the case. I said, let me go back in. And afterwards, he always had a gin and tonic when the day was over. And they all said, all right, you're absolutely right, we've lost the case. He wasn't. He was very critical of me. You shouldn't have been so. He had no right to do it. He recused himself, actually. And his wife was one of my best friends, Beth, she was her best friend. And I said, well, what's Lady Ormrod? What does she look like? And my friend Joan said, strange enough, she looks like a man, and she's never had any children. Life is very strange. This is Kate Moss. I said, first of all, I'd be sick. I'm scared. And I said, what is the fee? No fee. No fee, no fee. What are you paying Miss Moss? She's going to be paid thousands and thousands of pounds. And having to kiss that. I won't say it. On the first day, they were letting me out to go for a walk. It was a nursing trip, of course, because I was baby. And I fainted in the gutter. And I woke up screaming with laughter. You know, I suppose the people walking past me had too much gin or something. I said, why are you laughing? I said, I'm the happiest person in the world. And some of that still stays with me today. I've never lost that joy of when your body and your mind all become one.